executive of the Human Resource Management Association of Barbados. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, you must allow me to say at the very outset, ask your forgiveness if my speech is longer than ordinary. It is because I had a meeting with your president, and she required and commanded that in order for me to be fed and watered as splendidly as I was today, that I should speak for no less than an hour. Now, she seemed to have forgotten the statement by Bernard Shaw, that if you lay all the economists of the world end to end, they would never reach a conclusion. But here goes. The only thing about which there now appears to be a national consensus in Barbados is, if I may quote the words of Paul Valéry, that our future is not what it used to be. There was a time recently when our national affairs were inspired and driven by the statement of lofty development goals for the country and the active pursuit of programs to achieve them. In such a context, Barbados was committed to achieving the goal of full development. It was also judged that such a status should come especially to be expressed in a human form by the attainment of full development and the eradication of poverty. In today's world, our national affairs are now being conceived and structured to achieve far more limited objectives. At a time when other middle-income developing countries at our comparable level of development are succeeding in extracting growth from the same difficult economic arena in which we operate, we are being asked to accept a new and a strange form of passivity and powerlessness. We are being asked to accept that our economic problems are due entirely to the ravages of international recession, as if we are powerless to affect our circumstances by our choice of policies and by the strength of our own developmental initiative. We are left to believe that our best and indeed our only feasible approach is to seek to ride out the global economic recession, which does not incidentally exist, and to do our best to contain job losses and to minimize the reduction in the level of our economic activity. And for a country that used to accept that an annual average rate of economic growth of about 3% per year was the minimum necessary to support improvements in the quality of life of our society at large, growth rates of 0.1% and 0.5% are now being trumpeted as evidence of stability and progress. It might very well be that our biggest national challenge is not to overcome economic, but to overcome psychological barriers as we make ourselves the victim of a virulent form of recessionary psychosis. In such a context, it is refreshing that your association evidently feels that Barbados still has opportunities for growth in a depressed economy. And I am pleased to be able to share with you a perspective on this issue. There's nothing that I propose to say today that is intended to diminish the significance of the turbulent and unstable global economic environment as a factor which has borne and will continue to bear upon Barbados' capacity to realize economic growth and to move to a higher round of development. It also has to be understood that any country's capacity to grow and to develop at any point in time is also affected by its choice of macroeconomic management policies, which have a bearing in the short term on levels of economic activity, prices, employment creation, levels of investment, and on the state of its balance of payments. That capacity for growth and development, even in the midst of recession, is also influenced by the strength of the transformation of policies the country puts into effect to carry out sectoral diversification in the face of changing demand and resource availability configurations, new development initiatives it institutes to make the most of its comparative advantages, and its willingness to call into being entirely new developmental strategies to cope with challenges of a kind that it may never before have had to deal with. There will therefore be opportunities for growth, even in a depressed economy, where a country deploys appropriate macroeconomic management policies, as well as new developmental and transformation initiatives, and so structure them that they reinforce each other in a positive and in a harmonious way. However, the use of inappropriate macroeconomic policies and the inability or the refusal to implement new development initiatives can and will, by the same token, cause a deep spiral downward, prolong the recessionary conditions, and work to undermine the country's capacity for sustainable development over the medium term. In many important respects, Barbados's present depressed economic circumstances, although finding their genesis in global economic conditions, have been aggravated by the subsequent deployment of inappropriate macroeconomic management policies and the failure to deploy new developmental initiatives at the policy or the sectoral level, as warranted by circumstances and as certainly as was within this country's capacity to institute. I deal first with the macroeconomic response. When economic crisis occurs in small economies such as Barbados, they generally take the form of a cluster of problems, typically falling GDP, rising unemployment, falling foreign exchange reserves, rampant inflation, and declining investment, which as a bundle may vary in composition from time to time. The appropriate response to such crises depend upon which of the factors bulk most heavily in the bundle, and a careful balancing of policy responses to deal with it in such a manner that a response to one problem does not trigger unintended problems in other spheres of the economy. In all of this, one general rule holds and must be applied. The growth and development of small economies, where economic activity, even for the domestic market, has a high import content, is constrained by the availability of foreign exchange. As such, if during a recession, a small country is faced with a severe balance of payments problem, it effectively has no choice but to give priority to demand management policies to bring the external position under control so as not to impair its growth and development prospects. However, if the balance of payments do not bulk as the primary problem, and indeed, if the country has a sufficient volume of foreign exchange reserves to pay for the increased imports that can come from stimulating domestic demand, part of its macroeconomic management response to a recession can be to maintain or to increase private domestic purchasing power. A simple comparison of our economic circumstances over two periods illustrate the point. In 1991, Barbados was confronted by a recession accompanied by a balance of payments crisis of the most intractable nature. Indeed, at the height of the crisis, November 1991, the net foreign exchange reserves of the Monetary Authority, the Central Bank, stood at minus $38.3 million. Its liabilities exceeded its assets by that amount. And the net foreign exchange reserves of the country, the central bank and the banking system, stood at minus $2.6 million. Barbados had literally run out of foreign exchange. There was therefore no scope to stimulate domestic spending as part of the solution to international recession. And indeed, domestic measures had to be instituted to curb domestic demand. However, at the end of March 2008, when the present economic cycle started to represent itself, Barbados faced no such balance of payments problem. Indeed, the net foreign exchange reserves available to the monetary authorities and the banking system at March 2008 stood at $2,711,000,000. Significantly, every quarterly report of the Central Bank of Barbados since then have stated that the foreign exchange reserves exceed the level required as a safety buffer. And even the most recent IMF reports indicates that after 4 years of economic travail, Barbados exchange rate is not under pressure. There was therefore no prima facie case for the government of Barbados to respond to the economic cycle which manifested itself after March 2008 by recourse to policies to reduce domestic purchasing power through punitive taxation, new energy pricing, and other policies all aimed at curbing domestic demand. Indeed, with 76% of our economy driven by domestic demand and foreign exchange reserves at a historically high level, there was latitude to offset the falling international demand for goods and services caused by international recession by tax and other measures to stimulate private sector-led growth in this country. Later, I will examine available evidence to address the question as to whether, from a fiscal point of view, such a policy stance would have been sustainable. The cluster of economic problems that manifested themselves in the crisis that had its origin in 2008 initially took the form of a fall in GDP, accompanied by a crisis in government's fiscal position. The fiscal crisis, took the form of the conversion of previous current account surpluses into current account deficits, in some years exceeding $500 million. The emergence of overall fiscal deficits amounting to three times the levels deemed to be sustainable, and a rapid growth in our debt to GDP ratio to over 100%. Significantly, government has asserted that the incurring of such large fiscal deficits was not part of a countercyclical policy to use fiscal measures to stimulate the local economy. What has been of even greater significance has been the response of government to its own fiscal crisis and the impact of that response on our macroeconomy, on our enterprises, on the households of Barbados, and on our implications and prospects for growth. Government has responded to its own fiscal problem by treating it as a revenue problem. In this capacity, it could have chosen to allow the growth in revenue to come from the growth in the economy as distinct from increases in the tax rates, increases in user fees, and charges for inputs used by the private productive sector. However, beginning in 2008, government called into play a substantial increase in direct taxes and fees, major adjustments in charges on utilities and energy products, and followed more recently by the removal of income tax allowances and further increases in the VAT and the excise tax as the fiscal response in an economy already facing recessionary pressures from falling international demand. Not surprisingly, the use of such an approach, which has adversely affected household purchasing power and the viability of producing enterprises in Barbados, has merely succeeded in ensuring that the recession in Barbados in 2008, which was caused by a decline in international demand, has been followed and aggravated by recession caused by a compression in local demand. Indeed, Barbados' present economic situation should not be characterized, as it is by some, as being a case of economic stability. Rather, at the core of our economic circumstances is a new phenomenon that can be referred to as stagflation. This refers to a situation where a country experiences anemic or no growth, accompanied by rising unemployment and rampant inflation. Barbados recorded a negative growth in 2008 and 2009, followed by a fall in nominal growth in 2010, although it was claimed that despite that fall in nominal growth, real GDP grew by 0.1%, an amount that falls within the margin of error and which cannot be seen by the naked eye. It was reported that GDP was growing at a rate of 2.5% in the first quarter of 2011. The latest report of the central bank is that overall growth for the year will only be 0.5%. I say to you that an economy which was growing at an annualized rate of 2.5% in the first quarter of a year will only grow at 0.5% for the full year if there has been a substantial decline in economic activity after the first quarter. The Barbados economy is now expected to grow at a rate of less than 1% this year. The rate at which the Barbados economy must expand to accommodate increases in population, additions to the labor force, and to finance improvements in the quality of life is about 3% per year on a sustained basis. The growth that has been recorded and the growth that is projected following on the steep declines in 2008-2009 mean that the country is caught up in a situation of stagnation. At the same time, inflation in 2011 at 8.7% has been the highest rate since 1983. Due in large measure to the fiscal policy of the government. In addition, unemployment has increased from 6.7% at December 2007 to 12.5% at September 2011. This has occurred against the background of a situation where government has justified its taxation and its fiscal policy on the need to maintain public sector employment. As such, the price for government's policy, the price paid for that policy, containment of public sector employment, has been a loss of 6,000 jobs in the private sector. The tragic human aspect of this new syndrome of stagnation caused by punitive tax measures are borne out in the following indices. A household earning a monthly income of $4,800 in 2007 would have required a monthly income of $6,000 in 2011 to maintain its purchasing power and its standard of living based on average increases in food costs, increases in electricity and energy charges, road taxes, gasoline, rents, and insurance. However, there was no commensurate increase in income over the period, since wages had been frozen in parts of the private sector, especially tourism, and in the public sector after the last increase in 2008. Secondly, even if the household had found its incomes increased to $6,000 per month between 2011 and 2010 and 2011, the new provisions in respect of travel and entertainment allowances would have caused that household to have suffered an increase in taxes from $446 a month to $883 a month. For households living from paycheck to paycheck, this increase was brutal and has pushed many over the brink. In addition to this graphic evidence of current stagflation, the Barbados economy is also being affected with the phenomenon of underinvestment in three important respects. First, government's most recent economic report indicated that total domestic investment was $500 million less than in 2007. Secondly, private capital inflows, which amounted to $1.5 billion in 2007, fell to $90 million in 2009, have not recovered, and even though boosted recently by the sale of shares, are no less than half of what they were in 2007. And thirdly, government's own capital expenditure in 2010 was significantly less than government's capital expenditure in 1980, some 30 years ago. If these trends continue, and the current fiscal policies are allowed to deeply embed themselves in the structure and the function of our economy, the only certainty will be continued stagflation of the Barbados economy. The present and projected performance of the Barbados economy, therefore, justifies a major change and a reversal of government's fiscal and taxation policy, especially a reversal of the policies in respect to punitive taxes on personal income, which have done so much to reduce domestic purchasing power, to reduce local demand, and to reduce the growth in this economy. There will be no strong growth in Barbados if such a reversal in government's taxation policy is not undertaken. This proposal, reversal of government tax policy, raises two tantalizing questions. The first is, will government's reversal of its taxation policies, and especially the restoration of the former income tax allowances, generate larger fiscal deficits that are themselves unsustainable at a time when the fiscal position of government needs to be managed? That's the first question. The second question is, what can we learn from the comparable experience of another country whose circumstances have not been dissimilar to those of Barbados? The answer to the first question is in fact contained in an article published by the Central Bank of Barbados Review of March 2011, entitled, quote, "Fiscal Sustainability in an Open Economy with an Exchange Rate Peg," written by Anthony Belgrave, Jason Le Corbinaire, Delay World, and Denise Applegate. It was written at a time when the government of Barbados was in the process of putting in place tax increases as its preferred means of reducing the fiscal deficit. And it declared, even though the fiscal deficit for 2009 was very high, reflecting the adverse impact of the international economic recession, a much larger deficit could have been accommodated without depleting foreign exchange reserves or imperiling the exchange rate anchor of Barbados, end of quote. On the second matter, what did other countries possess of adequate foreign exchange reserves do? The statement in Singapore's national budget of 2011 is instructive, and I quote, Minister of Finance said, members will recall that government has sought and obtained the president's approval to draw down $4.9 billion from the past reserves to fund the job credit scheme and the special resharing initiative under the resilience package. We were in the midst of a global crisis of unprecedented scale. Our access to past foreign reserves gave us the resources and the confidence to deal decisively with the downturn. We have recovered well from the crisis, putting our fiscal position on an even stronger footing. Our crisis strategy has worked. The Singapore economy drawing on its reserves because they were adequate, grew by 14% in 2010, and was expected to grow by an additional 4.6% in 2011, if only we too. Realistically, any major adjustment in government's fiscal policy to stimulate private sector-led growth in Barbados through changes in tax policy must be accompanied by supportive measures to deal with the real fiscal problem that must be addressed. And that problem is the management and the control of government's expenditure and the more efficient financing of government's operations. Interestingly, the government has last week published its revised medium-term fiscal strategy, in which it has pushed back the date for the attainment of a balanced budget by 2 years, has committed itself to cutting expenditures by 0.5% of GDP, that is about $75 million, in each year in 2013-14 and 2014-15, after cutting it by 0.5% this year, ending March. But there is to be no reduction in public spending in 2012-2013, contrary to its original fiscal program. Interesting indeed. We are left to wonder what is going to happen between April 1st, 2012 and March 2013 that will allow the government, which has to cut expenditure, not to want to cut expenditure in that period. We accept that the most effective management of public expenditure in the context of a country that has too high a debt to GDP ratio, but which needs to reduce the rate of tax, must be an essential part of the process by which growth opportunities can be created in a depressed economy. Today, I wish to reiterate important positions my party has expressed on this matter. First, Barbados has made tremendous progress by investing through public spending in the development of its social sectors, education, especially health and education. We are reaching the stage where the social sector is becoming too large for the economy to carry. We must therefore create an environment within which greater private investment in healthcare and in education can be made in the event that government has to restrain its spending in these two areas. We should look, for example, to rehabilitate the QEH, and to encourage private investors to build new modern hospital facilities to supplement those at the QEH under arrangements that would allow government to have access to such facilities on negotiated terms, rather than our spending $800 million now on a new hospital. Secondly, in the event that the present universal access to government-owned healthcare and educational institutions have to be replaced by measures that restrict such access to only persons below a specified income threshold, tax allowances and credits should be allowed to persons to allow them to claim any new expenditure for such services against the tax liability. We call this our new program of fiscal incentives for social transformation. Third, government is asset rich but cash strapped. We will support the sale of publicly owned assets and the dedication of the proceeds from the sale of such assets to segregated accounts to enable us to service the debt and to meet an enlarged capital program without government having to raise revenue by taxes for the purpose. Fourth, our present problem is the simultaneous existence of too much overall public spending but too little spending on public sector employment investment. Government therefore has to rebalance its overall spending in favor of an increase for spending for capital purposes in both absolute and relative terms to create an environment that can spur growth in this country. Fifth, the use of public-private sector partnerships as the preferred means of carrying out large and lumpy public investments that have historically fallen within the scope of the state activities, for example, a new West Coast sewage project, must be utilized. Sixth, as a corollary, where investments were conceived to be entirely private in nature, government must resist the urge to take responsibilities for raising the funds for such investment, especially if it entails compromising the financial integrity of our national insurance system. And you know of that which I speak. Seventh, there must be no more printing of money to finance government's fiscal deficits. Eighth, there must be a moratorium in Barbados on the introduction of any new entitlement programs. And I may also add a cessation to spending on government's political partisan programs. Ninth, there must be a comprehensive review and overhaul of existing public expenditure programs with a view to making savings through administrative and institutional changes. And tenth, there must be a comprehensive reform of existing public expenditure programs with a view to making savings through the application of more effective technological solutions. I deal next with necessary developmental initiatives. It is clear that Barbados' growth prospects can also be greatly enhanced by seizing opportunities to take advantages of some of our competitive advantages and to implement already conceived programs to broaden and to diversify the mix of products and services which Barbados currently produces. Too many of those already conceived initiatives have been allowed for 4 years to remain fallow while the country drifts along without a clear program for its transformation. And allow me to touch briefly on some of the major areas where forward-looking policies and programs are needed to create an atmosphere conducive to strong growth. I deal first with the need for a new information communication technology strategy. There can be no disputing the fact that as a small service-driven economy, our ability to effectively assert ourselves in a technologically driven world will depend on having the most modern, accessible, and affordable telecommunication infrastructure. In addition, there was no doubt that the Barbados economy has benefited tremendously over the last decade, due in part to the work started in the year 2000 by the last Barbados Labour Party administration, which sought to liberalize the telecommunications environment. To illustrate this point, permit me to remind you that we ended the cable and wireless monopoly on telecommunications about 10 years earlier than its expiry date, and thereafter introduced competition into the telecommunications sector. Without policy intervention, that burdensome monopolistic arrangement would have ended in 2011. We introduced sweeping reforms which captured in the new exciting legislative framework, including the Telecommunications Act of 2011, the Fair Trading Commission Act, the Fair Competition Act, and licenses were granted to Digicel, AT&T, and Sunbeach, along with cable and wireless, to provide mobile services. Additionally, there are now 7 companies licensed to provide international telecommunications, 2 companies holding full domestic licenses, 5 with domestic fixed wireless licenses, 3 with domestic data licenses, and 5 internet service providers. The impact of these reforms was directly and dramatically felt by individuals and businesses all across Barbados. According to the International Telecommunications Union, in the period 2000 to 2010, the number of cellular mobile phones accounts moved from 12,000 in Barbados to 337,000. Internet accounts moved from 10,000 to 268,000. And fixed line moved from 113,000 to 141,000. Our telecommunication infrastructure remains critical to Barbados' development, not just as an industry in its own right, but as a necessary pillar in the growth and development of the services sector. Consequently, Barbados today must move to the next higher level of national ICT development. Sadly, hardly anything has been done post January 2008. What this oversight has created is a new digital divide within the regional landscape. One where Barbados is now being seen at the bottom rung of the telecoms connectivity ladder, while at the same time, our regional competitors are pressing on with the next generation of telecommunication reform. The reform agenda for the future must have at its core broadband internet access at high speed and at an affordable cost across the length and breadth of the country. This approach is critical for sustaining productivity and innovation. It has been shown in several advanced economies that broadband internet access by a wider population has improved social and economic benefits across the board. Indeed, a recent World Bank study of middle and lower income countries has concluded that broadband is a key driver of economic growth, noting that a 10% increase in broadband penetration can lead to an increase of 1.3% of the GDP. What is regrettable is that regional countries that previously envied our attention to ICT development and our telecommunication resources are now surprised at our lack of broadband and telecommunication progress. For example, countries such as Dominica are now enjoying the provision of fiber optic connectivity to homes and offices. Further, in a similar manner, Trinidad and Tobago and Grenada are all sharing in a comparative experience. Our regional counterparts are capitalizing on access to the latest technology, including enabled broadband with speeds anywhere from 25 megabits to 100 megabits, to facilitate internet access for customers
for less than $300 per month. In the meantime, Barbados today is still struggling to make 5 megabits affordable to its customers. Indeed, issues like these can severely impact our ability to attract foreign investment, since potential investors are now seeing other regional jurisdictions as being more attractive jurisdictions for the business. Lack of attention to ICT development is further aggravated by issues stemming from digital convergence, such as online multimedia broadcasting, which is continuously challenging our regulators due to antiquated legislation that is no longer relevant in a YouTube and Facebook era. And CBC, I want y'all to carry this, please. While we have liberalized the telecommunication environment, we must go further to officially recognize that CBC is no longer to be seen as having a monopoly on TV broadcasting. Currently, we are witnessing within the broadcast space increased competition for CBC from alternative subscription-based video services, and digital convergence had made it possible for computer-based technology to serve as a new television and online servers to become the new television station. Consequently, the need for a TV license on the books in its current form has been rendered moot. A new Labour Party government will encourage internet service providers to enhance their service portfolio through the provision of a television component. We will also seek to treat opportunities for video and digital content creators in order to facilitate the expanded distribution of content of these types of networks affordably and efficiently. In addition, every day since the internet has been part of the Barbadian lexicon, because there are no active internet exchange points supported by the appropriate telecommunication policy, Barbados and the region has been losing thousands of dollars in foreign exchange to extra-regional upstream internet service providers. These providers have been profiting significantly from an inefficient process that compels our consumers to depend on an outmoded and costly form of service delivery that allows these providers to transmit our local and regional data out of the Caribbean, only to transfer the data back to us like, quote, a trombone. A new telecommunication policy would help ensure that these internet exchange points are established to create data transfer points within the Caribbean, and by so doing, help reduce the delivery cost of internet service to the consumer, reduce our expenditure on foreign exchange, and provide a more robust and reliable Caribbean network. As we continue to rely more on new technologies, it has been recognized that a new national security concern has emerged, which is one of cyber security. While computer crimes encompass a broad range of activities, generally, crimes that target computers directly, there are some of a computer misuse nature that are so severe and heinous that not only do they expose confidential information or result in inaccessibility of systems, but they also lead significantly to very dangerous cybercrime issues. We must address this issue of the impact of cybercrime on our economy. It is especially important that we encourage wider access to high-speed broadband at affordable cost across Barbados. We therefore fully support other private sector business initiatives. Case in point, the efforts of the Barbados Entrepreneurship Foundation in facilitating the provision of free Wi-Fi access across the island. In addition, we are pleased to see the major competitors in the mobile market introducing 4G broadband technologies. However, the government must act. The government must use the powers of Section 33 of the Telecommunications Act, Chapter 82B, to establish policies that make broadband provision the minimum service standard as part of the universal service obligation of telecommunication licenses granted in Barbados. Additionally, the next generation of reforms must address issues related to number portability and local loop unbundling as indirect access. Furthermore, telecommunication is but a component of information and communication technology. To address the aforementioned issue, a focus on telecommunications alone will be insufficient. Therefore, there's a need to establish an updated telecommunication policy with a broader new comprehensive ICT policy framework that would seek to address these aforementioned issues in an efficient manner. And thank you for allowing me to establish that I do not suffer from a McCain moment. I did next with the issue of sectoral diversification, the second major issue of growth. Barbados' growth will depend more than ever on its capacity to transform itself into a producer and exporter of high-value services, and its capacity to take advantage of the opportunities that still exist in the global economy for small economies to succeed, occupying knowledge base and technologically sensitive niches. To achieve this, more of our future growth must come from the diversification of our mix of sectors. I have recently gone public on record as indicating that such growth can best be engendered by the aggressive development of Barbados as an important international business and financial center. For that is where our real potential for robust growth resides. It is where we have our greatest comparative advantage, but where we have only scratched the surface in making the full use of such advantage. Robust growth in this sector should come not just from issuing more licenses to existing types of enterprises, but from radically diversifying the product mix of the sector. In this regard, there's much to be gained from broadening the scope of our international business and financial center to encompass new asset management companies, to make Barbados a location for the clustering of family offices, to put in place, above all, a regime to allow us to attract new high net worth individuals, to offer Barbados as a location for arbitration, and to establish a floor in Barbados for international trading in securities. These opportunities exist because of the superior infrastructural, governance, institutional, and resource capabilities that exist in Barbados relative to that of competing jurisdictions. It is therefore regrettable that this opportunity is being squandered, as evidenced by the report that over the course of the past 3 years, Barbados has missed out on $1 billion US in investment and income, and over 2,700 jobs in this sector alone because of our failure to act. Barbados' transformation into a fully developed service economy must and can also be accelerated by the implementation of already articulated policy frameworks, and they are already existing, to develop our cultural industry and our creative economy, to make the greening of Barbados an economic opportunity, and to facilitate the development of alternative energy sources. As a mature service economy, the tourism sector still has much to contribute to our growth and development. But this can only be accomplished if our national focus is on developing our tourism industry as a premium product to fetch a premium price. Deviation from this course in respect of tourism as indeed any further deviation from the task of accelerating the development of all of our service activities will weaken our prospect of recovery from the current recession. Ideal is the next third possible source of growth, strengthening of building on our strength and removing constraints to improve competitiveness. Much of Barbados' growth and development of the past was made possible by our access to props such as trade preferences, protectionist trade devices, and unique tax benefits such as that with Canada, which will not be available to us in the future. Barbados' growth for the future will therefore depend more than ever in our history on our ability to build a truly competitive economy and to remove any constraints that stand in the way of such an accomplishment. We have, however, come to this juncture as a nation that is not without hope. According to the most recent Global Competitive Index, Barbados is ranked globally 43rd globally out of 139 countries, but ranked third in our hemisphere for competitiveness, only behind the United States of America and Canada. It is a powerful position from which to contemplate the future. In relation to the pillars regarded as providing the basic requirements for competitiveness, such as the quality of institutions or infrastructure, healthcare and primary education, we are in fact ranked even more highly. We are ranked 27th. As regards efficiency enhancers that lead to competitiveness, Barbados has received high grades in respect of high education and learning, ranked 27th. Technological readiness, we are ranked 22nd. And financial development, we are ranked 38th. However, we rate below our par on competitiveness pillars, having to do with our business sophistication, we rank 59th, and innovation, where we rank 53rd. These rankings make the adoption and support for the program of the Entrepreneurial Foundation of Mr. Peter Booz a very vital factor in creating the conditions for future growth in Barbados. What is instructive is that in this report, the most problematic factor that is reported that stands in the way of doing business in Barbados is reported to be the inefficiency of government's bureaucracy. There has to be a national consensus that Barbados' development must not be held back by such a constraint which is so entirely within our capacity and within the scope of our ambitions to fix. I have already elsewhere indicated that there can be no more acceptance of half measures on this matter, and that the exercise to address this avoidable deficiency should be marshaled by an agency in the office of the Prime Minister, and I would love to be in charge of such an agency. I deal fourth with human resource development. In addressing the Human Resource Management Association, I thought I should spend some time dealing with the key human resource development issue that bears on the future growth of our society. That issue concerns our approach to tertiary education, both from a human resource development point of view, but especially so, the development of Kfield Campus Resource as a business model. Barbados' development to date has been based largely on the availability of high quality skills that have been generated by sustained century-long investment in the education system. The quality of our human resources will become an even more imposing factor in the future as some of the traditional props of our development diminish in importance. We have come to this juncture in our development with no deficit in access to education at the primary level, no deficit in access to education at the secondary level, but with a tertiary education training access deficit, that though smaller than all other Caribbean countries, needs to be confronted. A recent analysis in the Central Bank's Economic Review of March 2011 of Barbadian student involvement at Cayville and the cost thereof to the government conducted an evaluation on the per capita cost of such education relative to that at the community college and the Samuel Jackman Prescott Polytechnic. Not surprisingly, it found that great savings could ensue if more of a tertiary education was undertaken at the two last reference institutions. We are therefore now familiar with the efforts being made to make a significant reduction in our financial national support for tertiary education at the UWA, an integral part of the fiscal program of the government. I would like to suggest that this is based on a false comparison of costs across institutions that are not similar in nature and are not performing similar roles. There are two levels at which University of the West Indies at Cayville can demonstrate its relevance to the development process in Barbados that requires us to deal with it beyond narrow fiscal boundaries. It can do so by promoting the human capital development process within the process of citizen empowerment that resides at the heart of a popular democracy such as Barbados. This achievement is well advanced and has been demonstrated conclusively. On this front, its success has been well established. But it can also do so within the context, and top of the University of West Indies at Cayville can do so within the context of a new economic model for Barbados that sees the campus community as an economic force and activity that drives capital formation and drives economic growth by first positioning itself as a public and private investment site to be exploited, and secondly, by positioning itself as a bridge between the national and the international economy that attracts foreign students, researchers, innovators, and entrepreneurs. In this regard, Cayville's potential to be a net foreign exchange earner for Barbados is indeed enormous. Especially after 2002, the then government of Barbados has significantly empowered the campus, invested in its potential to revolutionize its academic and physical capacity in order to drive the human capital base that underpins national development. The domestic private sector responded to that energy that followed government policy, came on board, and has made substantial investments in the campus. The synergies that followed produced an upsurge in interest in higher education and served to modernize the campus as a quality institution with an international aspect. In the 5 years since 2002, the dominant effect of Cayville's modernization has been its internationalization. Cayville became a respected, admired campus that for the first time attracted international attention and credit. There has been an influx of international scholars and teachers into the campus that has changed its internal dynamics. New facilities made the campus a globally sought after venue for conferences and symposia. Cayville is now at the center of the Caribbean's academic world. This is an enormous national achievement that must not be understated. It is a major national asset with considerable development potentials if effectively understood and if effectively mobilized. There is now a Barbados brand at Hayfield that has been internationalized. That asset is now a public and private good to be leveraged and to be commercialized. An immediate effect has been the heavy demand for the Hayfield experience by regional and international students. The influx is now beyond the capacity of the campus. The new medical program, for example, is now dominated by Trinidadian students who represent over 50% of the intake, despite the presence of a medical complex in their own country. This was anticipated. Hayfield is now the campus of choice within the university diversities. It occupies a status that Mona held during the 60s and the 1970s. Hayfield and Barbados are in fact ranked in the top 20 destination for American students wishing to have an international learning experience. The potential of the campus to exploit this lucrative foreign exchange market is limited by accommodation challenges. Building an international student village at Hayfield will liberate the market and generate millions of dollars of foreign exchange for our local economy. Already, the campus has reached, under existing physical conditions, its ideal demographic profile with a student base of 8,000. The approved model is 70% Barbados, 20% regional, and 10% international. This model can be adjusted or maintained with 12,000 as the approved target in 2015, which is considered the ideal economic and demographic size for the campus. It is imagined that 12,000 is the ideal size given the academic, technological, and physical parameters currently available. So it must be expanded. An aggressive exploitation of the international reputation of the campus can be a core variable in a post-recessionary economic model for Barbados. Indeed, Hayfield can and must be built out as a university township, as part of a regional economy that links the Warren Financial District to the tourism West Coast, creating jobs, earning foreign exchange, and linking communities to the financial streams. Hayfield is also shortly launching a science and technology initiative that can help to propel our country even more deeply into the digital age. Lime has promised a chair in digital technology. Sol has promised a chair and laboratories in new renewable energy research. And Piconco has promised a chair and an institute for electronic, civil, and structural technologies. The science park, centered around these themes, will be rolled out in the next few months. Within the university economy, there will be two aggressive centers. One, dealing with finance, banking services, etc., driving the traditional services sector. And secondly, a new science and technology core, driving our new digital economy. The potential of Hayfield is therefore considerable as an economic force, but it is a silent asset in need of liberation and in need of our advocacy. Already, the Hayfield campus generates more foreign exchange than the local dollars invested in its operations. It is a larger foreign exchange earner than most hotels. Its economic impact on its immediate community in St. James and St. Michael is large and profound. In 2010 alone, over 5,000 visitors came to Barbados as a result of campus operations, and there were several major conferences and meetings, from sports to symposia and graduation. The impact on domestic spend from such activity is large, is known, but is underappreciated. There are currently some 2,000 non-Barbadian students here who are part of the University of the West Indies as students and staff, visiting faculties, consultants, etc. The Cayfield development, therefore, needs not to be restrained, but to enter the second phase. And it must not be restrained by fiscal considerations, given its strategic national potential significance. The private sector is already on board. It has already invested over $20 million in the physical development of the sector. The international donor community is on board. It has already invested over $25 million in research grants for projects, etc. The local community wants an expansive role for the campus. Therefore, there is a tremendous opportunity for a new vision of the role of the campus in a national economy. Critical discourse on this matter is necessary and important, but the campus should be empowered. It should not be condemned, it should not be accused, and it should not be abused. It is a very telling irony indeed that captures the incoherence in the present course of our national development, that on one side of the road, there is the example of the Cayfield campus with a clearly identified program for its development into a university township, with the prospect of significant benefits to accrue to the national economy from its expansion in the form of increased national foreign exchange earnings, with a potential as a township to make a large direct financial impact on the immediate local community, and with a vast potential to operate as the chief link between our domestic economy and the knowledge-based global economy in which we have to operate. That initiative, sadly, is struggling to find official support and is in danger of being suppressed and reversed because of fiscal cuts. On the other side of the road, there's the example of a Four Seasons hotel with no clearly identified form of funding that is enjoying and engrossing official support and official attention, and which is being promised hundreds of millions of dollars by financing by the same government that wants to cut funding for the university at Cayfield. I must end this presentation to you on this matter on a personal note. I was the first member of my immediate family to enjoy access to a university education. There are, however, still many Barbadian families that do not know what it is to have a graduate in their midst. You must therefore appreciate the strategic significance that I feel that must be attached to the strategic goal of achieving at least one graduate per household by the year 2020. It is the ladder by which I climbed. I am therefore not in a position to join others in seeing this ladder kicked away. Many years ago, the famous German economist Friedrich List, commonly known as the father of the infant industry argument, wrote about how Britain and others, after enjoying protectionist duties and other devices to acquire industrial development, forthwith went on to preach to others the virtues of free trade. His sentiments, meant to apply to the development of industrial systems, I wish to repeat and to refer to. His sentiments, meant to apply in that context, are sentiments that can easily be made to be relevant to the approach that many generations of Barbadians should beware of following in making drastic decisions about the future of access of other generations to tertiary education. And I quote him, and I end on this note. He said, it is a very common, clever device that when anyone has attained the summit of greatness, he kicks away the ladder of greatness by which he climbed up in order to deprive others of the means of climbing up after him. Any nation which, by means of protectionist duties and restrictions on navigation, has raised its manufacturing power and her navigation to such a degree of development that no other nation can sustain free competition with her, can do nothing wiser than to throw away these ladders of her greatness, to preach to other nations the benefits of free trade, and to declare in penitent tones that it has hitherto wandered in the path of error and has now, for the first time, succeeded in discerning the truth. I'm obliged to you.